And we also divested from nuclear energy in 2009. We are really excited to see what we can do to keep pushing the envelope and keep doing more to bring Takoma Park into the future. I am excited that the topic is solar energy because over the last 2 years, I've been working really hard to help residents get cheaper solar through our solar co-ops. And we've seen over 35% increase in residential solar installations in Takoma Park in the last 2 years. So let's keep that going. And I would like to introduce to you Linda Pence Gunter from Beyond Nuclear.
Maybe it's, is it feeding through to you, but not to the room? It's gonna be. Although I think Keith's not, you're going to use a loud, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Is it on now? No.
That's better. Okay. So it's my pleasure today to welcome Keith Barnham, Emeritus Professor of Physics and Distinguished Research Fellow, Physics Department, Imperial College London, England. And you may be wondering how a British professor of physics found his way to the auditorium here in Takoma Park to talk about solar energy. And the answer is entirely appropriate to Takoma Park's fame as a nuclear-free city. It's a nuclear weapons connection. Keith and my late father were both anti-nuclear physicists and part of Scientists Against Nuclear Arms, which my father founded in Britain. But mid-career, Keith turned his focus to researching solar power. Among other achievements, his quantum photovoltaic group at Imperial College developed a third-generation solar cell with 3 times the efficiency of today's rooftop panels. He'll be talking about that in his presentation, along with other technologies, including photovoltaics, onshore wind, biogas from waste food, and underground heat pumps. As Gina mentioned, Takoma Park is already a nuclear-free city, and not just nuclear weapons-free, but also nuclear power-free. It purchases 100% wind power, and many of us can do the same at home. And some of us with sunny roofs can install solar panels. But can we do better? I think Keith's answer is going to be yes, we can, not only as a city, but as a country. And I think he's going to throw down a little bit of a gauntlet to Berkeley East, that's us, and Berkeley West, a little bit of a competition, so we'll see how we come out in that. Keith's research has led him to conclude that people power is the key to the renewable revolution, and people power is very much at the heart of the culture and politics of Takoma Park. I encourage you to read Keith's book, The Burning Answer, The Solar Revolution, A Quest for Sustainable Power, which Keith will be signing and which you can purchase after the event. Keith's presentation is divided into 3 segments, and we will take questions after each segment. So please use the stand mics to do that. Just line up once he's done with each segment and we'll take questions in order. That's important because this is televised live and we need to be able to hear your questions. And now, it's my pleasure to please welcome Professor Keith Barnham.
Thank you very much indeed, Gina and Linda, for the kind introduction and for inviting me here. Because I'm not even wanting to talk to you, I'm about getting it from the sun. I want to learn from you. You are at the grassroots of the solar revolution, and I'm looking forward very much to the discussions I hope that we hope we'll have tonight after each section. My talk, the slides will be up on the my own website hopefully in the next few days, and the ecologist is just uploaded an article by me that covers quite a bit of what I'm talking about today. Okay, getting it from the sun. That's what we should do, I think, now, and how we do it is what this talk's about. In particular, looking at comparing the USA and the UK, and very different political and practical situations in the two countries, and some similarities. There are here are these three questions that I'm going to be addressing, and as I say, I want you to hear your views about that after each of those. Okay, let's begin, first of all, with this bit of data, which here I want your input to try and interpret and explain a big mystery that this data reveals. This is the peak wholesale price, the maximum price during any given day that electricity achieved on the German grid in those years, for 2007 to 2011, at those dates. And you'll notice that it's falling with time. It's actually the difference between the peak price during the day, that's when demand is highest and they have to wheel out the most expensive generators, and the price at night, what is usually known as base load, when there's less demand and one can get away with the cheapest provider. That, as I said, has been falling, and it's interesting how it's been falling. If you look at you don't see the spot particularly well. At around the turn of the year, in each of those years, it wasn't falling as far. And that's explicable. That suggests it's the sun, that's PV power, that's something to do with it. Because, of course, the sun is lower in the sky in the winter. And this is our data at the bottom showing how much PV power had been installed in Germany by those dates, suggests that it could be it could indeed be the reason that PV is responsible for that. But it's interesting to see that even in winter, it's falling considerably, and you've got 20% fall over that period. And yet, the mystery I'd like your views on is how did the wholesale price fall by up to 20% when by 2011 only 3% of the German electrical energy came from PV, only 3%. And this isn't a quirk. The UK has now reached this sort of level and is seeing the same sort of behavior, the same fall in the wholesale price when, in fact, about here, it's only 1%. Of the electrical energy is coming from PV in the UK. So, any suggestions? Why? How this mystery? Could it be indeed it can't, that it's not PV responsible for this, if as the fossil fuel industry and the nuclear industry would like us to believe that we've got a negligible amount of PV? Well, my answer is it's all in the book. and I'll be selling that half price, $10, and you can have a signature as well at the end. Basically, it's because it's power that matters. When we come to keep the lights on, it's very important to realize you've got to balance the power demand with the power supply second by second throughout a year. And that's what the Kombi-Kraft work team in Germany at the Fraunhofer Institute for Wind Research at Kassel did. Ever since 2006, they've been taking feed from the German grid, and that's the demand, how it varies throughout a typical week. This is a typical week in September, don't think we can show that up. These are 7 days in September. Here's the weekdays with the highest demand because of work. When the weekends are lower demand. And what they do is that they take the actual output of PV generators, that's these yellow lines, and second by second, real time, they take the output of wind, some pretty wind farms at that stage, and they tell, on the basis of the wind and the PV, they tell bioelectricity generators how to vary in order to be opposite to the wind. When the wind is down, the biogas is up, backed up by the wind. So they're doing the thing in real time. And the first thing to notice, and the explanation for that remarkable fall in the wholesale price, is that when demand is highest during the day, it's around noon every day. And of course, the PV supply is highest around noon every day. And PV is cheap, and therefore that's why the price is reducing. Energy is actually the area under the yellow curve. And as a proportion of the total energy demand, which is the area under all the red curves, yes, it's very small, but it's the power that matters, and that comes at just the right time, the time of peak demand. That's when nature gives it to us. So that's why in the UK, with just 1% of the energy fall, we're seeing a similar sort of fall. Is there a better one? Thank you very much. That's much better. Great. That's fantastic. Thank you. Okay. When they started in 2006, there wasn't much PV in Germany. So they had to scale down the amount of that they were trying to and were succeeding in meeting the amount of demand. But as time's gone on, they've gone up to now 100% of the power, and they're now running, and they're finding exactly the same result, that PV and wind together can supply around 80% of the German power demand. Only 17% backup by biogas electricity was required. That's the dark green there. And most importantly, don't listen to those fossil fuel supporters who say we've got to spend a lot on expensive storage. Only 5% backup from storage was necessary. That's this solid blue line. Nowadays, they're doing the whole of Germany, taking generators from all over the country and simulating how the grid does, and it's still giving the same results. Mark Jacobson at Stanford, his group has essentially repeated this, but hour by hour. And they found for all the USA national grid is divided up into a number of state-sized subgrids. He gets very much the same result, 80% by PV and wind, as long as you have a variable backup. Biogas electricity is the obvious one, and a little bit of storage. So how are all these countries doing? Here they are. I plotted the installed photovoltaic power here up on this axis against year along here. Notice this very strange scale. They're expanding so fast, you have, instead of from going from here to here being 1, 2, 1, 2, 3 and so on, it's going up by a factor of 10 to be able to plot it here. For those of a mathematical bent, that means a straight line here is an exponential rise. And these have all been rising exponentially over the past decade. These limits up here came from the Combi-Kraftwerk experiment. That's the limit you need for PV, how much PV you need in order to have an all renewable electricity supply in Germany. And I've adjusted it for the UK, given we've got a smaller population and a better distribution of wind matching demand in the UK. And that Germany will reach the PV levels by 2020. And had it not been for the cuts, which I'll be talking about, the UK, all it had to do was to follow what Germany had already achieved. That's what that line is. And it would reach that by 2020. The USA is very interesting. It's going up exponentially very fast, faster than the UK or Germany. That means it's being installed at a rate that is faster than that technology. Those of you of a certain age will remember the end of the 1990s, how fast this technology rose. PV in the USA is rising faster than that. China going even faster. Interestingly, for part two, when I talk about nuclear, I do say that I think USA could be the first to catch Germany, because both China and Japan have nuclear programs. And as I shall show, you can't have nuclear programs and be good at PV. Here is a very fine example. Japan was leading Germany up until around this date when they decided to go for nuclear. That was a very bad choice, it turned out, in 2011. And of course, PV then took off again when all the reactors were shut down after Fukushima. But they're talking now about restarting a nuclear program, so I expect this to tail off. China, the PV and wind, let's look at their wind in a moment, is rising faster in China, PV and wind together, 10 times faster than nuclear. So the reasons for countries go for nuclear are many and varied, and we can discuss that after part two. But almost it does include the fact that if your nuclear is in trouble, then you impact on the PV, as we'll see later. Here's onshore wind. Here the US overtook Germany, and then itself was overtaken by China. Germany would reach all renewable levels by 2020. Had it not been for the cuts, the UK would have done by 2022. Now, here's something I want to discuss with you later, your ideas on why, if you notice, there's no US on this particular graph. Why no US offshore wind? It's I've been staying on the New Jersey shoreline, and it's pretty obvious you've got a lot of good wind resource there. This is amazing, and the government doesn't seem to want to publicize this. An exponential rise for a big new technology in inhospitable environment, and yet it's maintained an exponential rise until the new government is starting to cut into the subsidy. But where is the US? That's the one question I want to discuss. And yeah, it's US performance on this one. Remember, we need to back up with about 15 to 17% of bioelectricity. The US nominally is doing the best in terms of its bioelectricity, but it's mainly biomass. And we know that's going to be limited because it's fighting for land resource with crops. So that can never take off exponentially in quite the way, same way as in, for example, Germany and China are doing in terms of biomethane from waste. Why isn't the US doing more in biomethane from waste? Germany's got several thousand times more biomethane anaerobic digestion plants. That's one of the things I want to discuss. Now, here's a very important slide that impacts on the differences that we're going to have to discuss between the situation in the UK and the USA. You've got exponentially rising markets. That usually means mass production, and that reduces prices, and therefore the expansion continues. And indeed, the wholesale price of electricity has been falling in the UK and the US. This is not just the peak price, which I showed you earlier. This is the average price over the whole year, day, night, the whole thing. And it's been falling. And Good Energy, who I'll be mentioning again, an all-renewable electricity company has showed that it was due in 2014, that fall was due to the cheaper renewables. If you plot it along as the front, how far each country has got towards its all-renewable target, Germany is nearly halfway towards that target, as I showed earlier, you find they lie on the same curve. And what is important in this is that the electricity market be a free one. Now, one of the things I'm here to find out is how free the US markets are on the different subgrids. And I fear with your dominant majority monopoly organization of the grid, in which one company is doing the distribution, and it could be a company who's also generating as well, as sadly you are now going to be in this situation with your nuclear supplier, then you won't get this sort of effect, I don't think. And I'd be very much like to get hold of some data to see whether you do or do not in the USA. To get this sort of effect, you've got to have, as in both countries, both insist, the grid is actually run by an independent company, independent of any of the suppliers, and it has to take the cheapest electricity supplier first. It has to, by law. It can't just slip in its own expensive nuclear. So that's what, that's a free market. That's what's known as a free market. And one would have hoped that the country that is the capitalist citadel of the world would have a free electricity market and see the benefits of it. But it seems, as we'll discuss, we haven't got that here. Right, the anaerobic digestion to biomethane, I'll mention that 15 to 17%, what's happening in the UK and Germany. Here's an anaerobic digester, that dome there. What you put in there is farm animal waste, farm crop waste, food waste, particularly food waste from the big food manufacturers. And you allow it to decay to biomethane, which you can use for electricity generation, and you can put into the gas grid. Very important to realize that there has a low, particularly low carbon footprint. After all, think what would happen to all that waste if you didn't put it in there. It would lie on the fields or in landfill and rot to produce greenhouse gases, including methane, of course, which is 80 times worse than carbon dioxide as a greenhouse gas. So that's an extremely important point about this. And in terms of electricity generation, it is certainly the lowest, with hydro, the lowest carbon footprint for electricity generation. Now, why isn't it bigger in the States? I think one clue may be this particular one. Think about the solid that's going to be left behind after you've taken the biomethane off. It's going to have all the nutrients, all the nitrogen, all the trace elements that help the plant grow in the first place. So an obvious use for that waste is to put it back on the fields as a fertilizer. And it, of course, therefore challenges producers of most of your current fertilizers, which of course is our old friend, the fossil fuel industry. So that may be one reason why it hasn't taken off over here. The other, of course, being the fossil fuel industry wants to protect its, it wants to keep fracking. So, but this is the ideal way to provide that 15% backup to wind and PV, as we'll now see as we move on to the points for discussion. Well done, congratulations to you all here in Takoma Park. And great to see the work that you're doing here to get it from the sun. I gather all your renewable electricity in your city-owned buildings. Now, what I do at this stage in all my talks is to ask people if they have an all renewable electricity supplier at home or at work. When I do this in the UK, I've got to realize the difference in the UK. In the UK, I say we have a reasonable market in electricity. There are not only is the supplier, the company that runs the grid independent of the providers, but there are at least half a dozen suppliers, no, there's 8 to 10 at least suppliers, including one or two, Good Energies and Ecotricity they're called, who are genuinely all renewable electricity suppliers. So they bill you, and what they have to do, well, the way they work is that their software will tell them if you to make sure that there is enough renewable supply, wind, PV, or bioelectricity or whatever, to meet your demand. So I like to say it's not just offsetting, which is what often happens when if it's say a wind supplier as you've got here. It's a real genuine. It's just like going to your ATM. When you go to your ATM and you try and get some money out, the software running the ATM and running your bank will not allow you to take any money out if you haven't got it in your own bank account, right? We're a fact of life. It's the same thing with what Good Energies and Ecotricity do in the UK. Their software maintains that for every bit of electricity that they sell to a consumer, that they can back it up at the other end. They bought it, or the grid has supplied it from some other renewable supplier. They do that in hourly segments, so they are keeping an all renewable electricity supply going hour by hour. And therefore, in the UK, when I'm talking to a committed group like this, I usually get between 25 to 50% putting up their hands and saying, yes, at home, I've got an all renewable electricity supplier. So here, I'm going to be a bit careful about the question. After all, we're all here benefiting from the fact that your city has done a deal with wind. So you could all put up your hands and say, at the moment, we're being fully supplied by our activities at the moment, fully supplied by an all renewable electricity supplier. But no, my question is, how many of you at home have taken advantage of the Maryland law that says that you can choose your supplier and have chosen a renewable supplier? So could you put your hand if that's true, or if you work somewhere like, as obviously Gina does, which Wiz has already done that. What's the numbers? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Thank you, well done. That's 8 out of, what, 20, 25. So this, just like in England, actually, that's rather good. But of course, you're the leaders. And there's still great potential there for switching to all renewable energy. Because in Berkeley, when I ask that question, and I've asked it a number of times, there is zero response. Zero response. The situation in is not as good as you have in Maryland. PG&E are the monopoly supplier, and of course, what Berkeley can do, thanks to the Californian law on the community choice aggregating, what they can do is bypass PG&E, set up a CCA in which they can, which can then do their own, set their own, go to renewable suppliers and have their own contracts. And that's what they're probably going to do. And the great point about that is that the way they're going to do it is to say that all the residents of Berkeley, well, if they want to carry on with their beloved PG&E, will have to opt out rather than opt in. And so when I ask that question next year, if I come back, I'm expecting to have it moving from zero to nearly 100%, I'm hoping. Okay, so what are you going to do about it? This is where we start the discussion, here. I'm going to make a couple of suggestions, but I'm open to your, obviously, to your what you can do. Could you possibly catch up Berkeley before this all goes through? The new replacement for PEPCO will still have to allow you supplier choice. So could you encourage the residents and companies to switch? Could you have a big campaign to try and do that? And there's this other point I think is well worth thinking about. To be strictly all renewable, like the good energies and ecotricity are in the UK, you want it to be sort of hour by hour throughout the year, not just offsetting the amount. And that strictly, as we've said, most importantly needs about 5% of variable biomethane supply. But all you'd have to do and Berkeley will have to do this as well, and you could beat them to organizing that, I think, is to ensure you have enough waste of your waste that goes for anaerobic digestion to offset the amount of electricity you actually need from natural gas or whatever that's variable to back up your wind and solar. So that's a possibility, and obviously I guess the city here has to organize the waste collection and this might be a good way of doing it and organizing things, and certainly it will reduce your carbon footprint. So I think that's something to think about, but now I pass it over to you and any questions and any other ideas for how you might catch up with Berkeley, apart from getting your friends over there to opt out and keep them short of 100% for a few. Yes? Would you like to speak?
Opposition to the anaerobic digesters includes where that animal waste is coming from, mainly from the confined animal feeding operations, which rather than encourage the continuation of those inhumane and disgusting operations, is not to find a way to keep them in business and encourage the confined animal feeding operations. And that's a very strong reason for the opposition. There's also some concern about what is off-gassed or what comes when the manure is being processed in the digester.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Thank you for raising that. I think these are concerns, and I believe in California they may be part of the reason why it hasn't been successful, because it was a dairy industry initiative that I gather has run into trouble, and that's the only example when I visited the Berkeley Ecology Center, that's the only one they could come up with, and it hadn't gone well. I think there is a point about that. I'd like to see them in more humane terms, but driving up the Central Valley, you can actually smell it, and that would actually help. But it's a very serious point. And in fact, my personal view, and when I talk to the anaerobic digesters, they say that the best thing to do is the crop waste, bearing in mind that sometimes, whenever somewhere up to about half of when you the stalks and so on, when you take a crop, there's an awful lot of good vegetable stuff that is waste, and definitely the food waste in food processing. Those are the best, and they are far better, because the other reason that I heard that they were in trouble in California over the dairy is, of course, the cows had some of the best energy content out of that stuff already before the manure is dropped. So it isn't as easy technically to get the stuff out. And indeed, the place I showed, the rainbow, they said we don't use animal waste at all because it isn't as good. So thank you for that point. Any more?
While bio waste is the subject here, there's also other options like switchgrass, where you can cultivate a biofuel, and I know there has to be some care taken not to compete with food sources.
Yes.
But I think that it's reasonable to look at the use of land that alternates between food and fuel in cycles as a way of keeping a balance in the land and using some of the refuse from that processing to go back into fertilizing fields for future food production. So, we not only have the option of using it as a waste, but also cultivating some fuels that are not food per se. So switchgrass rather than corn, for example.
Yep, that is a very good point that ties in with what the guy at Rainbow Barrow Farm, anaerobic digester, did mention to me. A big contribution is the fallow year. Most responsible farmers do have a fallow year, and the crop in that. Of course, we shouldn't compete with the more humane animal husbandry, I would class that as a crop waste, and indeed that just shows the great potential there. Bearing in mind we're always being hit from the fossil fuel industry to say we could never produce as much as you need from this, but there are all these different approaches which certainly don't have to impact on land use in the way that biomass has. You can do it much better, for, as you say, from crop waste.
Hello.
Yes.
So my question has to do with some of the politics that are swirling around these issues. And just one example that's very timely is tomorrow in New York State, there's a public comment deadline that's been arbitrarily rushed. And what the governor of New York is proposing in his public service commission is that two-thirds of a clean energy fund, so $8 billion of $12 billion, actually go towards propping up old nuclear power plants on the Lake Ontario shoreline,
right,
instead of going to solar PV and wind and efficiency like it was intended to in the first place. But we're seeing that all over the country, actually, in different states. And Exelon's playing, in New York State, Exelon's playing the big role in that bad scheme. So, with Hinkley C in the UK, with old reactors here as opposed to new reactors trying to gobble up the subsidies for renewables and efficiency, I guess my question is, in Germany, how was the good pathway chosen, and what ideas are there for here? And to end on a more positive note, in the PG&E service area, Friends of the Earth and others have reached an agreement with PG&E to not allow Diablo Canyon's two reactors to get a license extension. So 10 years from now, Diablo Canyon will shut down as planned for decades and will be replaced entirely by renewables and efficiency. Right. And so it can obviously happen, but it's the sabotage of companies like Exelon Nuclear that's preventing this very promising energy future from happening.
That's a very important point, and a great leading for my next section. But can you, just before you sit down, bearing in mind that hopefully residents are watching this live going out at the moment, can you point us to a website if there's a consultation? Out of state people object to this? It's appalling plan. Can we? What website should we go to?
One website is Alliance for Green Energy, which is a New York-based organization. I don't have it memorized what the website is.
No.
Alliance for Green Renewable Energy Economy is one place. Another one is publiccitizen.org. They have an action alert. Both of these organizations have web forms where, and they are encouraging people all over the US and even Canada to weigh in, because the issues involved are that this will be a precedent that could then, a bad precedent that could then spread to other states. There's always the issue of people traveling to New York paying higher costs for everything, because businesses will have to, you know, recoup that money they're being charged, that surcharge on their electricity bills to prop up these reactors.
Absolutely.
And then also beyondnuclear.org will, as soon as possible, get all this up on our website too, so people can take part, take action by tomorrow.
Great.
By the deadline.
I hope listeners heard that, and everybody here, that's, before you go to bed tonight, object to what, it does sound appalling.
I had a question and a comment. My question is, when you talk about the 5 to 15% storage, how are you achieving that technologically? And then my other question is, I've seen photos of the installation of offshore wind turbines, and it seems as if the site becomes quite industrial. The enormous amount of cement needed to stabilize the turbine, and I'm not sure what the bird fatalities may or may not be, if anyone's monitoring that. Can you comment on that?
Yes, coming starting from the last week. There has been a lot of discussion on that, on in terms of the birds, in the terms of the concrete, of course, it's interesting to the I recently walked past the Sizewell nuclear reactor, which of course is on a coastline, and they're planning on a massive increase yet again in the size of the next generation one that's there. And you look out to sea and you see these what I think are beautiful offshore wind farms generating much more power already than that reactor could. Yes, it will need some concrete, but the I think it's being handled more responsibly than the building a nuclear reactor. It is something that I know that I have seen some of the discussions in the case of the birds, and how they've been talking with the Royal Society for Protection of Birds about that. I know that is going on. Your first question was storage. Germany pump storage, hydro pump storage, enough that, so it's you just pump up, pump the water back up, and then run it down when you need it. So that's the form of storage that's definitely preferred.
Quick anecdote about the Greater Gabbard Wind Farm, which you're referring to.
Yes.
Which is off the coast of Sussex. And actually, we were able to visit the control room of the Greater Gabbard Wind Farm when we went to see the Sizewell reactors. And one of the fascinating things about it was that because of the installation of the wind turbines, that had created a sort of reef environment that encouraged fish, which encouraged birds, and that they were incredibly savvy, and there were not significant bird strikes at all on the wind turbines. And it had created this sort of rather fascinating, flourishing natural environment out there. And in addition, because it needs to be serviced by personnel, the failing fishing industry, the people who work the failing fishing industry now drove the boats out and back to the wind farm because they knew the seas and they knew the routes. So it was a sort of win-win. And the irony was that, you know, we went into the control room of this wind farm that is right next door to the entrance to the nuclear power plant, where they wouldn't have let us in come hell or high water. Why not, you know? So that raised a very interesting contrast, I thought. So I just wanted to point that out. And the other, I think, you know, I love birds actually, but there is a sort of lack of understanding that bird strikes, skyscrapers are one of the biggest problems for bird strikes. So the objection to wind power, which we absolutely have to do, I find a little bit hard to take unless we're going to remove skyscrapers as well. And windows.
Yeah. That's a good point, if I come in on that. And also, the other criticism I've heard of offshore wind, of course, is from the Royal Air Force, who, of course, love to fly low over the ocean, and they're very worried about how this will mess up their communications. But nobody ever asks them what's happening to the birds when they're flying low over the ocean. So if we're discouraging, if those wind farms are discouraging the Air Force from flying low over there, then maybe they're doing something for the birds as well.
Not only in the electricity sector, but also as far for transportation, if one postulates that all electric vehicles would be deployed and just gasoline would be off the road, diesel engine would be off the road. And they were making a point that if the storage technologies that now are being developed by, let's say, Tesla and other companies are fully commercialized and really brought online in a very short period, that could be achieved by 2050. So, like, if you have any comment on storage as far as like electricity is concerned, and then the second one is referred directly to Takoma Park. Right now, there is also the possibility for any ratepayers to go solar without the need to have solar power on their own property. So Maryland has joined a few other states in the country where one can just subscribe to the power purchased by solar on a third-party location. And so, like, one can just basically have a bill of solar monthly and pay monthly according to the power produced by that slot that one has subscribed to. So that's another option for Takoma residents and for all others in Maryland.
Thanks very much. That was a great introduction. The first point, storage, to the third part when we get on to it. I'll come back to that. I'll answer that one at that time. But I think that sounds a very nice idea, coupled with Gina's solar co-op together. It's very important when I remember that, you know, if you don't remember anything else from this talk, remember that 80%. That 80% number of PV and wind. You know, you get it from wind at the moment, but PV is complementary to wind. It will peak at the time of peak demand during the day, and it's they're complementary in lots of other ways, as proved by this 80%. And I'll talk a bit more about the 80% in a bit. So yeah, push on. That is another point I should have raised. Push on the PV at the same time, so that you're doing you're complementary. And that sounds great. I mean, if you keep a 35% increase every year, keep that up, then that's going to be really that's going to be making a difference. And I'm not aware that Berkeley is doing that, so that would be good. Shall we move on? Right, okay, and we can come back to these questions on the later. Right, okay, a bit more audience participation. Wake us up. The famous cosmologist Stephen Hawking came up with a very interesting conjecture. He's pretty sure our universe is so big that there must be other civilizations somewhere in the universe. And maybe they're more advanced. We're, after all, a second generation. Our sun's a second generation sun. And some may be so advanced they've licked interstellar travel. So he asked the question, why have none colonized the Earth? Now, the first question is, does anybody know what Hawking himself regards as the answer to this? No? Oh, well, yeah, it's only $10 and you can read all about it afterwards. Hawking thinks that they've all discovered that E equals mc squared, which is the key to nuclear energy and nuclear bombs, and blown themselves up. Now that's Hawking's. Now what I say in the book, well, no, I've got another explanation. I think that there may be civilizations out there, but I think that some of them may well have discovered the equation E equals HF, which is the key to the energy in photons of sunlight, and therefore the key to the solar cell and the key to sustainable living. They may have discovered that first, before E equals mc squared. That, and therefore they have a sustainable life. They have absolutely no need to colonize anyone else. They've got no nuclear waste to dump on Earth. They've got no fracked gas to run out, and new wells to dig on Earth, and because it's the key to sustainable living. Now, the importance of that is that we live in a cusp, what I call a cusp universe, because an incredible coincidence, both those two equations, the one that is the basis of nuclear power, and the one which has, as we shall see, many times delayed the solar revolution, bombs and power, and the equation E equals HF, which is responsible for, among other things, silicon chips, laptops, mobile phones, and solar cells, were both discovered in the same year by the same man, Albert Einstein. So our civilization, as beyond nuclear knows only too well, could go either way. Our civilization, our one. And here is an example of how the in the UK, referring to the politics of what's going on, you maybe picked something up of relevance to New York here. Is absolutely no question, if you look at the details, how new nuclear is impacting on the solar revolution. What I've done here is plot the addition of all those four graphs earlier for the UK, onshore wind, offshore wind, PV, and bioelectricity. It reaches this staggering 32 gigawatts by 2015. Not a lot of people knew that. At our meeting when I met in Manchester, these were committed non-nuclear people, where I met Linda last. Only two people out of an audience of about 80 guessed that it was actually 10 times, 32 gigawatts is rather neatly 10 times what Hinkley A and Hinkley Point C, the two reactors, may produce by 2030. We're already, and it's got there since 2006. It's gone up by that factor of 10 in 2006. And 2006 was a very important year. It was the year the then Labour government decided to go for new nuclear. So in that time, nuclear power has not generated 1 kilowatt. hour of energy, or 1 kilowatt of power, but 32 gigawatts of renewable power have been installed. So what's the government's answer? To kill it. Remove the subsidies for PV and wind. They didn't put that in the election. They did mention for PV. They did mention wind power, that they're going to kill it in the election, but they killed PV as well, and it really does mean kill. Here's what DEC, that's the department concerned, these two blue ones over the right there, that's what they predict will happen now to all the renewables in the years to come. And this, bear in mind that you don't really realise how bad that is until you read further and say that for 2020 onwards, they're only expecting that onshore wind will expand. So by then, they're expecting PV and onshore wind to be killed, and only offshore wind allowed thereafter. This is what would have happened if we'd carried on just as we were before. And here's two assumptions. This one, the most pessimistic one, is that thanks to local efforts to get it to the from the sun, maybe a PV and wind, onshore wind, could expand at about half the rate that they achieved in their worst year of the last 10. And I've assumed that offshore wind expands at its worst year of the last 10, because the government doesn't completely rule it out. But you're going up, that's what I call the pessimistic one, and it's still way over what they're hoping for, what they're really expecting. And why are they doing it? It's all because of nuclear. They openly admit their first choice is new nuclear for future energy supply, followed by natural gas, then offshore wind, PV, and doesn't figure, and neither does onshore wind at all. And why do they do that? Here's where we come back to the link with nuclear, because here's what they think will happen to the wholesale price of electricity. Now, I showed you earlier that in the UK that's actually falling, and that's what's happening down here. It is falling at the moment, but the DEC very much hopes it will go up like that. That's it. They have various scenarios. That's their highest scenario, and this is their lowest scenario. Obviously, it's got to fit in with what's actually happening at the moment. But then they say it's going to go up. It's going to go up by 2025. Why do they say that? They say that the price must go up because they're using so much fossil fuel, so much natural gas, and the price of natural gas is artificially low, and it's going to go up again. This is a government that's pushing fracking and trying to maintain that fracking will be cheaper. Anyway, they want it to go up because of the completely crazy the subsidy they've got for Hinkley Point C. The builders of Hinkley Point C will be guaranteed that price in 2025, and they're guaranteed that price, whatever. And if it's more than the market price, which it clearly, even on their scenarios, will be, then UK consumers will be responsible for that, for the subsidy difference between what the wholesale price is and the maximum price. So if, in particular, if my pessimistic assumption occurs, follows, that's the dotted line down there, all that, more than 7p per kilowatt hour out of the 9.2p will be paid for by the as a subsidy. So this is even worse than what's happening in New York at the moment, I think. But it actually gets even worse than that, because at least for nuclear, because now I want to see what the situation could be on this pessimistic scenario for wind and PV, if the government doesn't succeed in killing them. Here is, you've seen this before for Germany. Here is a typical week in April, the demand, the UK electricity demand, looking very much like it did in Germany, perhaps a bit more in the evening because we use more heating from electricity in the UK, but very much the same sort of thing. And there, what I plotted here, and this is a program I'm happy to lend to anybody in Takoma Park. It's just an Excel spreadsheet for every hour of the year. So that's 8,800 rows, and Excel can handle that. And what I do is look at the demand, and then look at, assuming we've got by 2020, which we would do on the pessimistic assumption, we've got to the wind and PV at the all renewable level, then I take the resource for PV and wind together and just scale it by what I've chosen for the power, all renewable value. So this is what the nature will give us in that week in terms of electricity from wind and biogas. And it's a reasonably good approximation to the demand, even without doing anything to it at all. And of course, what the program will then do for you is say, well, if it's above demand like this, then storage will take that down to there. If it's below demand like this, then biogas will have to be turned on in this period. It has to be flexible. And it will and take it up to there. And that way you can find, you can check how much biogas you need, how much storage you need. It's a very simple approach. But what it tells you about nuclear is something extremely important. That when we get anywhere near this stage, the whole concept of a baseload electricity generator, something like nuclear that can only once you've turned it on, only run at a fixed output, day in, day out. It certainly can't go hour by hour changes as you need for the backup. It's completely obsolete. So for about half the year, you can see that half that week, you've got more wind and PV than you've got demand at that stage. And so the expensive nuclear will be competing with cheap wind and PV for the storage that we talked about. And it'll be no context. So politically, what happens is that there'll be no demand. They won't be able to sell it. EDF won't worry because they're guaranteed a price way above what the wholesale price would be at that time. They're guaranteed that because we, the British taxpayers, will be paying it. But politically, there's going to be all hell to pay because the only thing they can do with that electricity is sell it to France. Subsidized 7p out of 9p by the UK taxpayer. I cannot see, particularly a country that voted to exit the EU, I cannot see that working. So I think that's rather interesting. Okay, now back to this question. What are we going to do about the current nuclear reactors? Well, one thing is very important to make absolutely clear. It is not a low-carbon technology. Any use, if New York, say the governor is saying, well, we've got to do this for climate change reasons, that is absolute rubbish. What I did here for the ecologist, and there's an article about this last member, was go through. I didn't go through all 274 published life cycle analyses of nuclear. I went through all the three meta studies who looked at all those and then decided what were justified, what were strong enough in their analysis and critical enough in their analysis to survive. I went through all of those, about 80 analyses, and looked at them. I could only end up with eight. Six which were independent of other analyses and covered all five stages. What do I mean by that? The carbon emitted during construction, during fuel preparation, during operation, during decommissioning, during waste. We don't even know what to do with the waste, so how can we estimate? But anyway, there were six like that, and they had errors reflecting, very large errors, reflecting the fact, of course, that we don't know what to do with the waste, we don't know what's going to happen to it. Lots of uncertainties about, like that. Also, the very low, the amount of energy you'd need to extract the uranium if it's very low grade ore, and all these sorts of things. So these six were the six that I... And just to... For the sake, so that we could at least discuss them, the two that were published with industry data and were therefore somewhat suspect in terms of whether they were going to be reactors of the same type, and they, this particular metastate comparison actually considered the different variations there as independent and included them in their means, which meant they got a particularly low value. That's crazy. I think the only way to show it is to show the values with errors. These are suspect because they haven't considered enough range of possible scenarios. All of these that you can believe are consistent with a statement that says it's not been proven that it's below 50, the footprint is below 50 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour. That's very important. The independent Committee for Climate Change in the UK, has supposedly independent, has said that's what we've got to aim at for 2030. And it's not clear that existing nuclear reactors are below that. You shouldn't really consider at this moment the next generation at all, because none of them ever worked. How can you possibly work out the carbon emitted in construction costs if none of them have actually worked yet? So it's an open question. And so now is the time to any comments on nuclear. Or questions on how we come back now. Perhaps the question should be, what can we do about New York now? any points you'd like to raise?
On that queue, I did look up the website. So this is where people can take action on the New York situation. It's all one word, cleanupthecleanenergystandard.org/comment. cleanupthecleanenergystandard.org/comment. That's Alliance for Green Economies action alert.
Thank you for that. Does the governor, isn't it? Is the governor's trying to do that? Does the government argue that they're low carbon?
This is a carbon mitigation scheme. It's called the Clean Energy Fund.
Yeah,
and they're trying to argue that the four reactors in upstate New York are zero emissions, which is, as you say, not accurate. Mm. And
The alternative, of course, is to point out to him, he may want to conclude in the objections, that most of the renewables are down here, way below, well below the 50, are below there. And they're cheaper, and they're bringing the price down. In a free market, they will bring the price down. So these are all the reasons why they should be used rather than the nuclear at this stage.
One thing I wanted to add to the irony of New York is that it happens to be the place, Rhode Island, New York, where the first offshore wind in the United States is poised to take place. There's Massachusetts,
great.
And Paul knows a whole lot about the Gulf of Maine off of New Hampshire and Maine. And then, interestingly enough, the Republican National Convention is in Cleveland, and the Lake Erie shore is some of the best offshore wind potential in the country as well. So. There's tremendous potential for offshore wind. And right here in Maryland, the previous governor, O'Malley, with the support of groups like the Chesapeake Climate Action Network, based right here in Takoma Park, there's tremendous potential for offshore winds right in this state.
I believe Paul, Paul wants to say something. Yes. Yeah, well, you were saying that, then in fact, the utilities don't want to run them, is that right?
Right. I was just going to comment that one of the bottlenecks that we've got right now for offshore wind here in the Mid-Atlantic is that Dominion, which is the big Virginia nuclear power corporation, has leased up all the offshore wind area and essentially not doing anything with it. So they have they've got the lease rights for the offshore wind off the coast of Virginia,
right?
And they're looking to build a $19 billion nuclear power plant in Mineral, Virginia, along with their other. So they're pursuing this this new nuclear effort, which is going to be astronomically expensive. The $19 billion cost tag for the North Anna 3 nuclear power station comes from the the Virginia Office of Attorney General, who were, you know, quite concerned. And there is this, you know, not only the political battle, but the leasing rights are being bought up and then sewed up by the utility.
Okay, that's very important to be aware of that. That's appalling. Where are they hoping to get the money from? Not some sub, because that's it's not going to be commercial. It can't possibly.
In Europe. Some of it is is going to come from federal loan guarantees. That's the but the federal loan guarantees are not. They certainly won't cover the $19 billion. So they're going to be looking to ratepayers to cover those costs.
This is a third generation, is it?
It's not even really that. It's these are souped up pressurized water reactors, so they're not yet third generation, but
is what Hinckley Point, in my view, it probably is a souped up.
Is that a third the ESBWR? Okay, Kevin says it is a third generation, but it's a boiling water. They call it economic simplified boiling water reactor, but it's neither simple nor economic.
I cannot see, after the experience of Hinckley Point C, that any new generation reactor is going to get any money from anywhere. If EDF can't build it, and Areva can't build it, apart from the Chinese, of course, and that's what we've found in the UK, there's nobody else prepared to put that sort of money in. There's certainly no commercial. And the government is as crazy to back it as clearly the UK government is. So it does sound a crazy scheme, particularly if they're sitting on it needs to be exposed, the complete the fact that, yeah, at the moment Hinckley Point C is unlikely to go ahead even with these completely crazy guarantees, which are government guarantees in just the same way, and when we've got the guarantee, there'll be, and this being funded by governments, not the it's effectively being funded by the French and the Chinese governments as well, and yet it probably won't go ahead because even with all those guarantees, they know full well at EDF that they haven't got the prototype working. I mean, that would be my other point. It's in no other field of engineering practice would you ever start building a reactor, would you start building a scheme while the prototype hasn't worked, before the prototype has worked. No commercial funder would ever fund that. Only governments do that sort of thing. And therefore, it's completely crazy. But just coming back to, we've got to separate, it's very important to separate this difference between old reactors new generation, because reviving old ones, something to be borne in mind, but certainly about the old about the second generation reactors in the UK, they're running, EDF are running them at about 50% load factor or below. That means half the time they're off for one reason or the other. In a year. Now, bear in mind that the Denmark, in practice, the leaders in wind, their offshore wind farms are running at about 50% load factor. One thing that's always thrown against wind, as distinct from nuclear, is that nuclear will run all the time for the year and give you that infamous base load. Whereas in fact, they're converting, you know, in terms of performance, how much of the year they're crossing over. So old reactors, all the estimates that I've seen for the new generation is having ridiculous 80%, 90% load factors assumed, which a completely new generation of nuclear reactors that's running 90% of the time when they're up and running in order to bring these figures down. They're completely unrealistic. So I think another argument people may wish to use with New York is to say these old reactors, new offshore wind, like the one off Long Island, could do at least as well in terms of its how much of the year it's generating for as a nuclear reactor. The one thing in favor of a nuclear reactor is its constancy, and it's not. In practice, old reactors are getting old and are having trouble keeping going. Yes, sorry.
I know this is a discussion about nuclear reactors, but what have you, in all your research, have you looked at the role energy efficiency could play in reducing the load and dramatically impacting these all these calculations you've done?
That is an extremely good point, energy efficiency. But in terms of the UK, which is where, of course, I'm arguing, the very interesting thing is that it's actually happening, even though the government's not doing anything about it. Since 2004, the electrical energy use in the UK has been falling year on year. And I think a lot of that is due to the fact that people are getting more efficient about the way they use it. I hate to say this, but I do discuss some ways of the energy efficiency could be improved in the book. I think there are some very simple ways that you could use in the UK, in the USA, because what is the situation in the USA? Do you know whether it's
dropping.
It is dropping as well. Very.
Or it's leveled out.
It says leveled out. Yeah. That's
but
great.
In the UK, you've got a shortfall in new building in the UK of about 100,000 buildings a year.
Mm.
And you're only building 100,000, right?
Yeah.
And the big realization I've just had is the role housing authorities can play in the UK.
Absolutely.
They
yes.
could drive the market, right?
Absolutely.
So
it's a very good point. Yes.
And they're looking right now to fill that shortfall by building in a factory.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you could build to the passive house building standard, dramatically reduce the load.
Absolutely, yes.
And you could retrofit.
Yes.
Because you've got energy poverty over there rising.
Yeah.
And you could look at direct current and the role it can play.
Yeah, all good point.
And all of those things would dramatically, and you could lead the world because of the power of those housing authorities.
Yeah. Right. Well, thank you for that. Yeah, I absolutely agree, and it just reminds me of one of my favourite schemes for the US to which I think I would put down as energy efficiency because it's existing technology. That's the it's one point, and that is air source heat pumps. We're staying in New Jersey, and it's sweltering, and it's humid, and there's what's the big demand? It's the air conditioning unit filling up half the window. Now, if that was an air source heat pump, which took out the heat out of the air in the winter and put it in, then as long as it's the reversible sort, it could do the exact opposite during the summer. It could act as an air conditioning unit. It would the fact that you're using the heat in the air outside, it's all explained, by the way, in the book, is that means you're saving, you're using that heat and your electricity. Were you heating by electricity, you drop by a factor of four compared to that. And the most important thing is, yes, aircon is one of the major reasons why, in fact, in lot great parts the US, in particular California, where I've been spending the last six weeks, the demand doesn't peak at noon. It peaks in the afternoon because of the aircon. But there, yes, sensible building design is
definitely what you want with aircon, because and the thing I was pushing, we got as far as launching a company to do it, and I discussed in there is blinds, intelligent blinds that track the sun and to focus, but are transparent Fresnel lenses, longitudinal Fresnel lenses, and focus the direct sunlight onto a light pipe, a narrow light pipe, a luminescent light pipe. And I'll discuss those in the last section. And that way you can blind the direct sunlight. So you you cut your air conditioning demand. Because, of course, it's one of the major contributions, the direct sunlight that gets into the room or warms your opaque blinds. You generate electricity in the frames of your window. You're doing it in double glazing. This tracking is very easy, following the sun. And, of course, you get the diffuse sunlight in between the blinds, and you don't have to do what everybody does when the conventional blind work. You have to switch the lights off. You don't have to do that because the diffuse light is very good to work in. So that's my favorite energy saving, but absolutely right. That as well could make a very big difference.
I just wanted to point out that Forbes magazine last month had an article by Amory Lovins with the Rocky Mountain Institute that pointed out that energy efficiency is responsible for the lowering of electricity demand for the last 8 years. Mm-hmm. So demand is dropping, as the Rocky Mountain Institute attributes to energy efficiency.
Great. Shall I move on? The final bit then, because I can. Summarize some of the points earlier in this final section. Here's a typical roof in the UK, and in the average UK sunlight, that provides enough electrical energy over the year to give an electric car, in the battery of an electric car, provide the average domestic mileage. Now, these numbers are bigger in the US, but then so is the amount throughout the US. There's a higher intensity of sunlight over the year. And indeed, parts of the US, there's double. Kevin, my friend who took this photograph, gets more mileage from in the Southwest, near where I live, out of it, because he and his wife work from home during the day, and so when the sun's shining, they don't have to use the car. But of course, that's not very practical if you want to use the car when the sun's shining. And now I bring in my solar cell, and here it is. I don't know whether you can see this at home, but what I'm holding up there is there's a tiny little square in there, an opaque square, which is a chip. It's a gallium arsenide chip. It's our triple junction solar cell that has an efficiency, power efficiency, three times what you have on your typical rooftop. That little dot in there, and that means. Oh, by the way, what it most resembles is the gallium arsenide chip that made this technology possible. So you've got at least one of these chip of that size in there, and it made that particular technology possible. So you could have three times as much power, so you'll have excess, more than you need for the house, more than you get at the moment. And you'd have even more than you'd actually need to charge, excess would be more than you need for the electric car. So what are you going to do about it? Well, as the questioner asked earlier, it's all about how you're going to store it. Batteries are expensive. The lithium uses fairly rare resource. And my answer is the best way to store it is to do what nature does. Stores the carbohydrate or the sugar it needs to grow, and it produces it from the carbon dioxide in the air with the aid of sunlight. And what you want is an artificial leaf, which they're working on, a number of people are working on, particularly in the States, but elsewhere in Europe as well. And I've just been had these 6 weeks in Berkeley talking to the experts on the artificial leaf. And there is what turns out, what to me seems a very important breakthrough in this technology to communicate to you. Because all the chemists I talk to back in Europe all say, oh, I say the obvious, what I'd like to produce is methanol from the carbon dioxide. That'd be the easiest. It's the nearest to a carbohydrate, only two more electrons per carbon dioxide molecule. And they all say, oh, that's very difficult. Even more, I'd prefer to produce ethanol, as I discuss in the book, because it's not toxic like methanol, so you might find it easier, much more safe to produce on your rooftop from an artificial leaf. But they say, oh, that's far, far more difficult. And I get to Berkeley, and I find more than a couple of researchers have produced more ethanol than methanol. And but a lot of other, the big problem is they produced a lot of other carbon compounds as well. So they were nowhere near the situation that nature does of just producing sugar. But it's real progress. To produce the more of the one that was more difficult must mean it's you're getting somewhere. So how would we do it in practice? I'm proposing, and I came to Berkeley with this suggestion, which I've now had to modify, as I'll explain, but basically suggesting we could use our cell with generating three times as much power from the same area in something that I want it to look like a current solar panel. At the moment, these small cells are deployed in large concentrators, which are full of lenses, which cheap plastic lenses that focus on these small sizes by 500 to 1,000 times, and therefore bring the whole cost down. Because you're not covering the whole area with this tiny thing, but you're covering the whole area with cheap plastic. Then they our cells are in the Arizona desert, and apparently they work quite well. I was pleased to hear. But in the Arizona desert, you can afford to track a big set of those things. On a rooftop, you certainly won't want to track. You've got to keep the sun focused on the cell, so that means you have to track. And what I was proposing was small trackers, very small units inside the panel tracking. A bit complicated, but we see Berkeley is suggesting that isn't necessary. But there's a couple of very other very important points about doing this on the rooftop. In the UK, or indeed in Maryland, where you're near the sea, you don't have the direct sunlight that you have in a desert. You have an awful lot of diffuse light scattered off high clouds, water vapor in the air, and so on. And so you need to collect that because that's what a conventional solar cell does. It collects both sorts. So what I was proposing at the back there, behind our cells, our small cells, was a sheet like this. Which is a concentrator of diffuse light. It's only diffuse light in here. We haven't any sun. It's basically absorbing light there on the top surface. And then inside, there is a dye in this example, which radiates red light in all directions. And a lot of it is trapped and conveyed to the edge. So in fact, you have the concentration there of sunlight, of the red sunlight, could be higher than the concentration that falls on the top there. So that was going to be behind the tracking lenses, so that you could, as the lenses moved, you would pick up a lot of the diffuse light that comes from all over the sky make up for the fact you weren't in the desert where it was all direct sunlight. And then the other thing you have to do is to allow for the fact that the spectrum of the sunlight is very different from what you had in the desert. And here I need to explain how our cells get their three times the efficiency. What they are in that tiny little chip are three cells, one on top of each other. Each the first one, which takes absorbs the ultraviolet and blue, and then radiates blue, allows the green and red through to the green cell. It absorbs the green, and then allows the red through to the bottom cell. And so you're taking each bit of the sunlight and you're absorbing it in a cell where you can most effectively use the that energy of the sunlight. The trouble with that is that if you move to a different spectrum, you have to be able to change the colors. And the way you change the colors, quantum cell technology was to put a quantum well in, and that a quantum well is a well. That's a well in there. That's running along. There is a well with a lower absorbing a lower, longer wavelength color than the outer two regions, and it's called a quantum well because there's only a few atoms you can do that. It's an early nanostructure, and there's a few atoms across there, and perhaps between 5 and 10 before you go back to this other one. So that's a quantum well. And you have a quantum well inside the chip that made this work. Electrons can move very fast along the quantum well. That's what you need. In our solar cell, we have to have 50 of them to get the right sort of absorption, but we've licked that. And that enables you to adjust for the different climatic conditions that you get between, say, Maryland and the UK, and why they differ from a desert. I got to Berkeley and found that they'd, I know they've been working for many years on this this idea of replacing the dye in here by a quantum dot. A quantum dot is like our quantum well, but instead of being that long dimension there, and this the very short one of a few atoms, it's very short, just a few atoms in that dimension as well. So it's a dot, right? So it's it's the electron is held in place by a few atoms in both directions. It becomes a dot, a crystal that is actually a nano dot. They're very good for this application. The reason that you can see there's a problem with this dot, that's supposed to be blue, and it's degraded the number of times I've given this talk, that is a bit of a problem. Okay, so penultimate slide, since I've been here's thanks to what Berkeley now, what they've found is super efficient, 100% efficient quantum dots that turn sunlight into red. They found a replacement for that dye. It's 100% efficient in the job it does. And they've also found a way, that's bad news, the fact there's red light coming up and down. They found a way of putting coatings on there which will act as mirrors and reflect the red and blue light within and do a better job of concentrating the sunlight. So this is what we're now proposing, putting our little cells in this sort of concentrator, an awful lot cheaper, this concentrator, just made of plastic, essentially, with the quantum dots and our quantum well cells inside. And we take electricity out of there. These get very hot under concentration. The heat can be used to absorb and desorb the carbon dioxide from the air in a nanostructured filter. So that's all good news, and we've got some flux out here to of two wavelengths with which you can illuminate your leaf, your artificial leaf, when they've finally got the right one. So that's I'm not a chemist. I'm not going to tell you how the artificial leaf works, but we can provide them in this way some cheap photon fluxes, highly concentrated by this method, and hopefully make methanol this way, and it will be available a lot more quickly than seemed likely when I wrote the book. So I'm going to put things right now. While I show you this, I'd like to, you can be reading my conclusions, and we've obviously discussed most of them some time, but this, I'd like to tie this particular conclusion that I now find, compared to when I wrote this book, that free gasoline for life is more likely, and it could be actually ethanol, which I would much prefer. And it ties up actually with the making nuclear obsolete before it does any more damage, because it what I said in the book is, if only we could get ethanol, we could get there would be another explanation for Hawking's conjecture. So if you don't mind, I'll read you a bedtime story, which I've tried to liven up a little bit by trying to make it a little bit more topical. So this is my conclusion now, given that in these last 6 weeks in Berkeley, I've really realized that this book needs updating. So watch out for the subtle topical references, not so subtle either. Okay, so what I did say was, sadly, my chemist friends tell me that because ethanol is more stable than methanol, and because it requires a second carbon dioxide molecule to produce one ethanol molecule, it is harder to synthesize directly. This suggests ethanol produced on domestic rooftops will be a second generation application for the artificial leaf, whichever that is. Okay, but we can now at least imagine that in the second generation, we can add another reason why an alien civilization that discovered E equals HF before E equals MC squared might not bother to colonize Earth. Because using E equals HF, perhaps they discovered the artificial leaf, were able to stabilize their carbon dioxide levels early on in their development of carbon-fueled transport. They had no warning planet to escape. Indeed, let me picture a scene which may be happening at this very moment in a remote corner of the cosmos. Okay, if there are any physicists here, I'd better be pedantic for them. I mean, the scene will be played out as far forward in time as it takes light to reach this remote corner. I was stuck for what to call them, and should I call them Alien X and Alien Y, as I do here, or not? I've got a slightly more topical version. Mrs. Trump, relaxing on the balcony, calls out to her husband, "Darling, you're not watching that awful reality TV show again, are you? Surely it's not the one you were in, is it? Come and join me and have some of this lovely fruit cocktail that I've made. It's spiked with our own homemade solar ethanol." "Just a moment," replies Mr. Trump. "I'm watching Earth Enders. It's horribly fascinating. Do you know the Earthlings are fighting yet another war over who owns the decayed remains of 100 million year old plants? And anyway, I might find a better speech for you to copy." "You mean, Mrs. Trump, you mean Earth scientists still haven't invented the artificial leaf? What is the world coming to? I'm so glad we decided to have nothing to do with them." or invade them. Thank you for your attention. Any questions on the last part?
I just realized I was remiss not to have mentioned a tremendous victory here in Maryland that was won by groups like Beyond Nuclear and other Takoma-based groups like NIRS and CCAN, and that was stopping the proposed new EPR reactor at Calvert Cliffs 3 on the Chesapeake.
Oh, wow.
And so by doing that 5 years ago or so, that really opened up the opportunity for solar and wind to happen in this state. And another group that's based here is Institute for Energy and Environmental Research. And Dr. Makajani, the president, is looking at a renewable energy plan for the state of Maryland, has been for years, in great detail. And so these victories are being won. And just to end that, that EPR, this evolutionary power reactor, as it was called, Electricité de France, AREVA project.
It was AREVA. Yeah.
Here in Maryland.
Right.
Because it was the flagship in North America, it ended projects in upstate New York, in Missouri, even on the Canada side of Lake Ontario. So at least seven EPRs were stopped here in North America, more than that, if you count the Canadian ones, because of the work that was done here, a lot of it right out of Takoma Park. And it gives this potential for wind and solar and efficiency to happen.
Absolutely.
In this state.
Absolutely, that's fantastic. That's great, well done. Well done.
Do you think you could postulate that one additional reason that we haven't been contacted by extraterrestrials is that they've heard that Donald Trump might succeed?
Yes. Yeah, that's a good one. Yes.
There is another success that was revealed in the so far unsuccessful battle to stop the Exelon-Pepco merger, and that was in Illinois. Exelon had asked the legislature for $800 million, and the legislature turned it down.
Great. That was from lobbying from green groups, I mean, what, local green groups?
I can't answer that. I didn't even know that had taken place.
Oh.
And I've seen nothing actually written about it. I do want to pursue that. But in the facts that they had been able to find as reasons for rejecting it, which unfortunately didn't prevail, that was one of the issues they came across, that the request from Exelon for the $800 million to the Illinois legislature was rejected.
That's very good news. Do you think it's going to play out here locally with them? I mean, they're trying, is this right, that they're trying to up the your bills? I mean, what's being done? You know, is there a groundswell of opposition to this, or what's...
Well, on the Exelon in Illinois point, at our website, beyondnuclear.org, especially in the nuclear cost section, there's a lot of information up there about Exelon's shenanigans in Illinois. And there are green groups at the grassroots level, like Nuclear Energy Information Service in Chicago, that's 35 plus years old. And they've been at this battlefront for years, and Exelon's lobbyists have thought for three sessions of the Illinois legislature that they would get this huge subsidy. And it's actually, that's a one-year figure, so it's more like $1.6 billion that they want. And a part of it too, a part of the political reality in Illinois is that there's this impasse between the parties. There's this budget battle that's gone on for years now, and so there's no opportunity for anything to move in the legislature, which on this particular issue, this huge nuclear bailout, yes, is good news. But yes, the state is in dire straits financially in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of tie-ins between what's happening in Illinois, what's happening here in Maryland, what's happening in Washington, D.C. And Exelon, its lobbyists are getting traction in New York State. This is the biggest nuclear utility in the country, with a couple dozen reactors all told in its fleet. And they are succeeding in certain places. They are failing in other places. And let's hope that the appeals against the Exelon takeover of Pepco in the mid-Atlantic will succeed, you know.
Oh, okay, there's an appeal.
There are appeals in Maryland and also in Washington, D.C. So let's hope that, you know, a lot of our allied groups that are engaged can prevail.
Okay. Can you?
Yeah, I was wondering how far away, how many years you think we are away from having a commercially available artificial leaf?
Oh, well, yes, I'm going to be, it's a very good question, which I'm going to skirt around because I it's quicker than I thought. I can say that. I can tell you what I thought in here, and it's quite interesting because it relates to a prophecy of that actually converted me to from particle physics to solar energy. That basically 2028 was going to be the crunch year. This was a prophecy I wrote that I read in 1979. When I looked back, it was terribly influential in my changing my field at the time. When I looked back, when I came to write the book, I realized that this guy had actually postulated that there would be, or predicted that there would be a terrorist outrage in New York in the early years of the 20th century, and that a big a hydrogen explosion at a nuclear reactor in a country that he put France, that used a lot of pressurized water reactors, he didn't put Japan in 2008. He was only 3 years out from 1979. His prediction was 2028 for a solar fuel approach. He said hydrogen. I don't think hydrogen is not safe enough for your own roof. I would now say, that's what I said in the book, so I've got to stick by that and say that it's going to be quicker than that. It's going to be quicker than that. I should be very disappointed, if it's not by 2024. 24, 25. I mean, it depends how much is put into it. But there are a number of breakthroughs here, I really can't comment on the chemistry. Just to say that the chemistry looks more promising, and I'm so sure we can now produce the optics and the physics parts of it. I'm sure those could be produced pretty quickly. So within the next. 8 or 9 years, I should hope.
I need to leave, but could I buy...
Oh, yes, please. Yes, yes, thanks. What an example. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Okay, that's great. What can I...
Just sign in.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. Hi, sorry.
Yeah, I wasn't here earlier, so I don't know if you had covered this or not, but nuclear fusion, is that practical within the next 15, 25 years, or?
That's a very good question, because I've, bear in mind, in the UK, there's more expenditure on and a lot of other countries too, maybe over here too, almost certainly if you include the IGF, more expenditure on research on that than there is on solar, on solar and wind and renewables. I would definitely think we've got to get a replacement for gasoline by 2028. I mean, I think that's going to be about the crunch. We've got to get a replacement for gasoline. All my predictions are about the countries like Germany, the UK, and probably greater parts of the US could be all renewable by 2030. When we're all renewable for our electricity generation and we've found a replacement for gasoline, that has... slow global warming, that's got to be done well before the 2050 or whatever they're talking about for a commercial fusion reactor. So it's a complete irrelevance in my mind, apart from the fact it takes more money, more research money.
The argument they've always used is, of course, we've got to cover. We'll carry on using electricity, won't we? But as you pointed out, in developed nations at the moment, we're not using more electricity, even though we have got the electric cars, and if we can produce the gasoline on rooftops, there's no need for it anyway. So I don't see any new need for fusion at all, if once we're sustainable, the whole point about sustainability is that it's not going to stop. It's not going to run out like uranium or something like that. So we won't need it. I am very, very, very worried about anyway how they will. I don't think nuclear has never been commercial, so I can't see them producing a commercial fusion reactor. There's a very, very fundamental thing. When they finally get ignition, which I'm sure they will do eventually, they've then got to solve the problem of what sort of containment material will hold it. And that, even the then head of the UK program actually admitted that that ought to be going on in parallel, that sort of research. What material? They're not. They're doing it in series. So you've then got to find a material once you've got fusion that would actually hold it. And it's not true, like the fission or stories about it being low carbon and so on. It's not low radiation. The tritium, what you do with tritiums are nasty, and how you make sure that in a commercial reactor and none of that leaks out, given that it's leaking out from nuclear fission reactors. And of course, there's all those neutrons flying around that are going to make the whole thing pretty radioactive. And yet another, when we haven't even solved the fission problem. So, great question. Thanks for that. Gave me the chance to expound on one of my favorite topics.
All right. Well, let's give Keith another round of applause and thank him for coming.
Thank you very much.
And encourage you to purchase the book. Keith will sign it for you. And thank you all for coming.
Yeah. Thank you.